Hey everyone, welcome back to Paul's Hardware. Today I'm bringing you a review of this graphics card from MSI, the MSI RTX 5090 Supreme Liquid SoC, which means it's overclocked, it's liquid cooled, and I'm going to be overclocking it some more, as well as comparing it to the RTX 5090 Founders Edition.
Excellent!
Today's video is brought to you by the Paul's Hardware store on paulshardware.net, the only official source for Paul's Hardware merchandise, tantalizing t-shirts, brilliant beer sets, high-quality hoodies, and more, all featuring the classic thumbscrew for tasteful and refined viewers, or the 8-bit thumbscrew for tasteful and refined viewers who hate curves. New designs are added sporadically and at random, so head over to paulshardware.net and get some of that sweet, sweet merch right now. Or not right now, after you watch the video. Either way. Before I get into my review and my testing results, I need to point out something very important about GPUs in general and GPU reviews. The GPU at the center of this graphics card, the RTX 5090 Founders Edition, is the GB202-300. That's the same GPU that powers this card right here, and indeed all RTX 5090s, and while all of them will perform basically the same or within certain tolerance levels, but they're also all going to be a little bit different in terms of their performance or their ASIC quality, their ability to achieve certain frequencies at certain voltage levels, and some are going to be a bit better than others. That's a limitation of pretty much all the GPU reviews that you see. Even people who are testing an RTX 5090 Founders Edition probably only have one GPU to compare to versus having a stack of 10 or 20 or something that would give a much better sample size. So, keeping that in mind, I've been really interested to compare other RTX 5090s to the Founders Edition because other manufacturers like MSI are going to be able to differentiate their cards by putting a unique cooler on it, by adding extra features like a dual VBIOS, and in the case of the MSI Supreme Liquid, also adding liquid cooling with a 360mm all-in-one liquid cooler attached. But let's start with the basics, a quick unboxing of the MSI RTX 5090 Supreme Liquid SoC. It's very well packed. It comes in a large box with sort of a dual layer foam setup to protect the 360mm all-in-one radiator underneath and the GPU that's up on top. In terms of accessories, there is basically just one. It is the 4-way 12V2x6 adapter, and MSI has made theirs a little bit unique and functional by making a two-tone connector for the GPU side, which is yellow on the plug part. Basically, you want to plug that in all the way so that the yellow is not showing anymore. That gives you a bit more peace of mind that your GPU is going to be powered by something that's not going to melt. Of course, next up I had to do a little bit of peeling, missed one right there, to get all the protective plastic off of this graphics card so I could use it. And here we can see that MSI has carried over a lot of the design work and aesthetics of the RTX 4090 Supreme Liquid that came out a couple years ago. It has a very nice looking silver gray brushed metal shroud with the Supreme logo, a bit of an angle right in the center of it to give it more of a distinct look versus having it just be flat. And here we can see the fourth fan from this setup. There's an additional fan on the cooler itself to help push airflow across the VRMs and the memory, and that is definitely a useful addition. Next to that fan is a bit of RGB lighting in sort of a chevron shape, and it lights up white by default, but all the RGB LEDs on this card are RGB and controllable with the MSI software. On the side of the card, we have a plexiglass Supreme logo that is also RGB backlit, currently showing in white. That's next to the 12V2x6 connector, and I noticed when plugging this in that MSI has added a little bit of extra heat pads just on top of that, just to help keep that area as cool as possible. And then flipping around to the back plate, we can see MSI has continued the brushed metal look with a nice two-tone feel here. We do have the Supreme logo down on one end. It doesn't light up this time, but MSI has added another Supreme logo sort of on the corner, so that one's going to be very visible for a lot of different types of case layouts. The other functional aspects of those cards are going to be the video outs, and those are the same video outs as the Founders Edition, three display ports and a single HDMI. And the final functional add-on is the dual VBIOS switch, which comes default in the silent mode, but of course you can switch that over to gaming mode, which gives you a nice 45 or 50 megahertz overclock. And I find a dual VBIOS switch to be more useful for the fact that you can actually have more than one VBIOS loaded up, switch back and forth between them, and especially for anyone who gets into more advanced VBIOS modding, it's a great peace of mind feature to have there as well. I should also mention the Supreme Liquid 5090's size. It manages to both be smaller and larger than the Founders Edition. It is larger in terms of width or height, depending on how you have it oriented. It's about a centimeter taller than the RTX 5090 Founders Edition in that regard. It is also thicker than the Founders Edition, the Founders Edition being a true two-slot card. This one is more like 2.5 to 2.7 slots. You could call it a three-slot card, but you do have a little bit of clearance there in case you're gonna have an add-in card dropped in just below it. And then it's also just a little bit shorter, being 11 inches long versus the Founders Edition, which is 12 inches long. Of course, those measurements are not including the 360mm all-in-one liquid cooler, which is standing by itself right over here. That is gonna need to fit in your case somewhere, so don't get this graphics card unless you have room for a 360 AIO, possibly along with your CPU's 360 AIO if you have a liquid cooler for that too. But my first impression of the cooling radiator and fan setup is that it's pretty well put together. It has three 120mm fans, and those do feature daisy chaining technology. You can see the connector on the last fan in the setup, and then those are wired directly through the AIO sleeving and connected to the graphics card. So the graphics card is going to control the fan speed for all four fans in this setup, and yes, all four fans have zero fan mode, as you can see right now. If the GPU isn't under load and getting hot enough, the fans won't spin. Now that we've taken a closer look at the card, let's get into some test results. I'm testing with a Ryzen 7 9800X 3D, and my goal is to show typical gaming performance and then run those same tests in an overclock mode to get sort of an A-B comparison between Founders Edition to the liquid cooled card, as well as stock to overclocked. I'm using Cyberpunk 2077 for testing. It's running at 4K with the ray traced ultra preset, but I have DLSS and frame generation turned off. I do have a DLSS quality test I'll show you in a minute as well. And basically I ran the game for 15 minutes to let all the hardware warm up, and then I did this benchmark pass that you're seeing now using RevaTuner with the performance overlay, and I'm capturing the gameplay on a separate system. So here's the test with the MSI Supreme Liquid SoC. Typical fan speed was about 32%, and the GPU clock was about 2565 MHz, fluctuating between about 2450 and 2650. GPU temperatures were nice and low, 52 to 55 degrees Celsius, despite the modest fan speed. And I should note that this is running on the Silent VBIOS. Our average FPS was 59, and again, that's with the ray traced ultra preset. Meanwhile, GPU power draw was between 550 and 575 watts. If we add the RTX 5090 Founders Edition for a side-by-side, we can see that that is definitely running a higher fan speed at about 48%. The GPU clock is roughly the same, maybe slightly slower at about 2550 on average, but fluctuating between 2520 and 2580 megahertz. GPU temperatures, though, are significantly higher, about 20 degrees, ranging from 74 to 75 degrees Celsius, and our average FPS is only affected very slightly by that slightly lower clock speed. It's at 58 average FPS versus 59, and our GPU power draw is between 495 and 560 watts, and do note that the MSI card is powering two more fans plus a pump versus the two fans in the Founders Edition. I did do the same benchmark run with DLSS quality enabled. That upped our frame rate to about 102 FPS on average. GPU clock for the MSI card was 2720 to 2760. And curiously, the GPU power drops to about 530 to 555 watts, but do note that we are using upscaling, so the game is being rendered at a lower resolution, and there's slightly less load on the GPU. Compare that to the Founders Edition, which is getting about 97 frames per second on average, with a clock speed between 2600 and 2650, and a GPU power draw of 500 to 520 watts. Next up, let's dabble in some overclocking using the MSI Afterburner utility, and I will say preliminary overclocking because it's clear that there are some limitations in place right now, probably put in place by NVIDIA, and maybe for good reason. For example, the power limit for the Founders Edition can only go from 100% up to 104%, which doesn't seem like that much, but it's a 575 watt card, and the power connector is rated for 600 watts. 4% of 575 is like 23, I think, so that brings you right up to that 600 watt limit, and you probably don't want to push much beyond that, at least if you don't have a card that has some sort of supplemental power. I also want to point out that with the dual VBIOSes on the MSI card, the Silent Profile VBIOS has a 575 watt limit, whereas the Performance Profile has the full 600 watt limit, or whatever, 575 plus 4%, it's like 598 watts. So for overclocking, you can switch to the Performance Profile, or you can do what I did, which is just still run it with the Silent Profile, but just max out the power limit with Afterburner, and then you essentially have the same thing. For the Founders Edition card, I was able to push the GPU core clock to plus 235. For the MSI card, I got a little bit past that to plus 240. That resulted in a 2752 megahertz boost clock. And then for both cards, I did plus 1000 to the memory, resulting in an effective memory clock of 15,001. So with those settings dialed in, I jumped back into the Cyberpunk 2077 test. And here I found interesting behavior from the MSI card in particular. It didn't seem to want to actually push up to using the power limit that I had just given it, at least not with these settings, ray traced ultra, but with DLSS turned off. You'll see in a minute what happens when DLSS turns back on, but here our clock speed was around 2,500 to 2,650, so slightly higher, but not that much. Our GPU power was ranging from 460 to 540 watts, and our average FPS was only 59, which is the same result as it was without the overclock, so that was slightly disappointing. The other aspect of my overclock, though, is that I cranked the fan speeds up to 100% just to get the maximum amount of cooling and theoretically the maximum performance out of the card. That resulted in a GPU temperature that was nice and chilly, between 43 and 47 degrees Celsius under load. But I will say, with this test at least, the Founders Edition performed a little bit better. Its clock speed got up to 2,750 to 2,800 megahertz. The power draw was much more in line with our expectations, with the 104% power limit, 565 to 590 watts. And we at least saw some improvement in our test run as well. We got up to 61 frames per second on average versus 58. Yay, three more FPS. Meanwhile, the 100% fan speed on the Founders Edition, which is very loud by the way, got the GPU temperature down to 61 to 63 degrees Celsius. Now switching over to this same test, but with DLSS quality enabled, we saw different results. I will say it looked like the MSI card was being utilized more, with the clock speed that now got up to 2,960 to 2,980 megahertz. GPU power draw was between 550 and 580 watts, and we saw an improved result thanks to the overclocking too, 107 FPS average versus 102 before the OC. Our GPU was also running at 47 to 49 degrees Celsius. Again, that's with fan speed at 100%. Compare this all to the Founders Edition, which suddenly seemed to not be utilized as much with DLSS enabled, with the clock speed ranging from 2820 to 2850 megahertz, 520 to 535 watts power draw, 101 FPS average, and the GPU temps at 56 to 59 degrees. Let's get into some more benchmarks in slide format, but first here's a quick look at my testing hardware in case you were wondering about the specs of my test bed. It's all listed right there. And here are the GPU clock speeds, the frequencies that these cards are supposed to run at. We have the base clock and boost clock as listed, as well as a maximum testing frequency, and I have both the performance and silent VBIOS listed here. Please do keep in mind those are maximum testing frequencies I'm showing, so if you'd like a more real-world look at the frequencies the GPUs are running at, jump back to my live testing. My next two slides are going to show the most significant differences between these two cards, starting with GPU temperatures. This is at stock, and it was taken after 20 minutes running Cyberpunk 2077 at 4K. We have a pretty significant 15 degree drop in the memory temperature, and that is one of the shortcomings of the Founders Edition card, was slightly higher memory temperatures. And then we have about a 20 degree Celsius difference between both the GPU temperature while under load, as well as the idle temperatures, because while both of these GPUs have fan stop mode, with the MSI card, the pump continues to run, and you can see the difference in temperature there down to 37 degrees at idle. The other big difference between these two cards is gonna be fan noise. I tested at 40%, 70%, and 100% fan speed, and especially at lower speeds, and do note that the MSI while under load was running at less than 40% fan speed, but the Supreme Liquid SoC, especially on the silent profile, is very tuned to emit as little noise as possible, and this is much more noteworthy down towards the lower RPMs. Once you crank it up to 70% or 100%, it does get a lot noisier, but it does stay a bit quieter than the Founders Edition. And finally, here are a couple quick benchmark runs just to show the difference in performance between my stock and overclock profiles. This is 3DMark times by Extreme. The most significant difference is in the graphics score here, where at stock we went from 25,300 with the Founders Edition up to 26,300 with the Supreme Liquid SoC. Overclocking the Founders Edition allowed it to get up to 26,800, but doing the same thing on the MSI Supreme Liquid SoC got it up to just shy of 28,000, and I double checked this on the 3DMark TimeSpy Extreme graphics score Hall of Fame. I would have scored 8th place right now with the Founders Edition overclock, and I would have landed in 4th place with the MSI Supreme SoC overclock. Lastly, here's a more traditional benchmark pass with Cyberpunk 2077 at 4K, and here we can see the actual frame rate differences going from stock to overclock. This is without DLSS enabled, so you can get a higher frame rate by enabling DLSS, as I showed you in the live gameplay. But also, just bringing things back to reality, what we're really looking at in terms of actual performance differences going from stock to overclock or going for these overbuilt cards is just a couple FPS, maybe 3 or 4 at most. So hopefully all my test results have shown some important differences between these cards, but the most important one of all I haven't even mentioned at all yet. The price. The MSI Supreme Liquid SoC is supposed to have an MSRP of $2,500 versus the Founders Edition, which is $2,000. Now, perhaps it is going to be the case that the MSRPs of all of these cards isn't going to matter one bit because they're all going to sell out and no one's going to be able to buy any of them except from scalpers. But I at least must assess the value of these cards based on the prices given to me. Is a $500 premium worth it for what you get out of the Supreme Liquid SOC? I would say probably not. But if this is the only card that's available to you, then it's probably going to be the one you go for versus others that are just vaporware. Practically speaking, there are some advantages to the all-in-one liquid cooler. We have an overall much lower operating temperature for the GPU. The card runs much quieter than the Founders Edition as well. So if having a very quiet running system is important to you, then that's something that might be worth a bit more of an investment versus the Founders Edition. I also did not do noise measurements of this because it's much quieter, but I will note that there's a lot more electrical noise that you can hear from the Founders Edition, especially if you're running anything at like a really high frame rate, like if you're in a game menu or something like that, versus the Supreme Liquid SOC, so that's something to keep in mind as well. For small form factor builders, I'd like to say that this is an option, but with the very large radiator, it seems like if you are space limited, you probably are still going to want to opt for the Founders Edition. But honestly, I'm just as curious as you guys probably are to see what happens in just a couple days when these go out for sale at retail. How long will they last? And will anyone actually be using this video because they're trying to choose between these two cards and they actually have them available? I don't really think that that's going to be the case, but for anyone who does manage to get themselves into that enviable position, I hope this video has helped you out in choosing between these two graphics cards, which I think both have their pros and cons. Thank you guys so much for watching this video. A big thank you to MSI for sending over the RTX 5090 Supreme Liquid SOC for me to review, and you can find a link to the MSI product page for this product in the video description, as well as a link to the Paul's Hardware store at paulshardware.net, where you can buy yourself some high quality merchandise to help support my channel. If you enjoyed this video, you can also help me out by hitting the thumbs up button, and if you want to post a comment, your thoughts on these cards, that's always welcome in the comment section down below. Thanks again for watching, everyone, and we'll see you all in the next video.